Hello everyone, this is Evgenia here again. Good morning, good afternoon for some of you, good evening. So if you're interested in the future of credentials, of challenges in migration of access control system, and possibly cloud infrastructure is the choice, this talk is for you. I invited Despina Stamatelos to join me in this talk. Hi Despina, welcome. I'm so happy to have you with me. Please introduce yourself and let us know what do you do at Genetec, and of course, my usual curiosity, what coffee do you like?
Hi, Evgenia. Thank you for having me. As mentioned, my name is Despina Stamatelos. I'm the product marketing manager for access control here at Genetec, based out of Montreal. And my coffee of choice is a latte with low-fat milk.
Oh, I love that one. So welcome, Despina. So let's start with the general trends in access control market. Please share your thoughts.
So over the last year, we've seen quite a few trends, actually. I would think of five of them that I'd like to talk to you about. One of them being frictionless biometrics, mobile credentials, the cloud, as well as being able to do what you're able to do with your access control really beyond the door, as well as cybersecurity. And so just to start with frictionless biometrics, so over the last year with the pandemic, people wanted to have options for their employees that would reduce contact. So anything that wouldn't allow contact got a huge increase in demand. So, you know, facial recognition, the waving of the hand, we saw a big increase in those items, and we expect that to continue. In the same element, mobile credentials, because again, they don't need contact. We saw an increase in mobile credentials. And in fact, research shows that mobile credentials will grow by 1,000% by 2024. Unfortunately, over the last year, we also saw an increase of cyber attacks, most recently in the news, you know, in the United States, in an oil field, as well as now in a meat plant recently. And so customers have become more aware of their access control system and the protection it has, because access control can be used as a point of entry to an organization's network. So they're thinking about cybersecurity for access control. You mentioned the cloud. You know, we're still working from home. Many people have been working from home over the last year. And operators who had to manage an on-premise system, it becomes more complicated doing it from home, especially when you're dealing with a legacy system that doesn't necessarily comply with the needs of customers today, what is going on. And so we've seen an increase in customers' interest in cloud access control or a hybrid access control. And in fact, we expect our sales and cloud sales to increase by double over the next year. And finally, customers want to be able to do more with their access control. You know, when we think of access, it's open and close a door, but you could do so much more. And again, during the pandemic, customers came to us and said, you know, how can we manage occupancy rates? How can we track somebody who may have come in contact if they were contaminated? And so we're looking at how we could use our access control well beyond the door.
Great. Well, that's a lot of information. So let's talk about each of these trends and for the banking and retail spin. So that, of course, I like to start with basics. And for me, cybersecurity is number one priority always when I have a conversation with my customers. So what do we see in general? We see a 4,000% increase in phishing emails, cyber attacks with the COVID pandemic are increased dramatically. And normally for our industry, it means that, if we take the statistics about the cameras, we know that every 4 of 10 cameras has a known vulnerability. It can be the vulnerable firmware, or it can be even worse, the standard credentials, the passwords are never changed. But what does it mean for access control world? What are the components which we need to consider?
Yeah, there are many items to consider when it comes to protecting access control, or what I like to say, protecting what's meant to protect you. And really, it's starting with a credential. Unfortunately, many organizations still use proxy cards, which are very insecure. And in fact, in the EU, 50% of organizations still use unsecured credentials, which could be a big issue. Then when you look at the reader or the communication between the reader and the controller, depending what protocol is being used to communicate, that can easily be hacked and tapped into. An encrypted access control architecture can be a big danger. And again, it's not about necessarily only going in and stealing personal data, which is big to begin with, But, you know, people with malicious intents can actually gain access to the company's network and cause much bigger damage. And that could cost the company a lot of money. An average cyber breach can cost an organization about $4 million USD. So it's pretty big.
This is very interesting. I recently watched the webinar of the access control manufacturer where they asked the audience if they view the proximity and magnetic stripe readers an unacceptable risk. And 68% of the audience responded positively. And I can as well reflect it on my customers. Some of my customers who still use Prox cards don't think that the risk is acceptable, but it's simply where they are at the moment, where they're stuck. It's not the matter that they don't want to change. I think they do want to change. It just comes down to the mechanism for them to change. And from my side and from our side, from the Genetec perspective, it's our job to lead them through the process of this migration and how to phase it. It's not the matter of switch on, switch off situation. And it's probably not the matter only of the choice of the readers situation, a choice of the future technology and what you can use now and what will you use in the future. And about the future, taking in consideration that we have options of the mobile credentials or biometric credentials where the identity becomes a perimeter. My question to you, do you think that smart cards, encrypted cards is something which is going to be obsolete in the near future?
Yeah, I don't know if they're going to be obsolete. As mentioned, Prox cards are still being used, which I would think and hope that they were obsolete by now, but they're not. Like anything with security, and especially with access control, organizations are very slow to change. And oftentimes they change after an event, so they're much more reactive than they are proactive. Having said that, both encrypted cards and mobile credentials are just as secure. But obviously, there's benefits to using a mobile device for your credentials. Number one, you don't have to carry any extra cards on you. People tend to carry their mobile device with them, and they don't lose it as easily. If you have to have credentials for multiple different buildings, you could keep all those credentials on your mobile device. So it is more convenient as it is secure, for sure.
Yeah, and I can give an example that, let's say I forgot my card and I go to the office and I will be registered. The receptionist is going to see that I'm in the database. I'll get in, but then I want to go out for lunch or smoke a cigarette. And then I'll come to you and I'll say, can you give me your card, even if it's a smart card? And you know me, and this is the mentality still that you know me, you will give me your card. But if you have biometrics, face, hand, your mobile device, it's something which you will never give me. It's something private, right? And the question is now that, what is the advantage or disadvantage of using cards instead of the biometric devices? What do you think about it?
Yeah, so you raise a very good point. You know, as secure as a card can be, like an encrypted smart card, people do pass it on to other individuals. We've all done it. Yeah, sure, take my card, go for your smoke, bring it back, I'll be in my office. So obviously that causes a security risk. Your mobile device, you're not going to give it away. You know, I might get a text from my husband that I don't want you to see while you're outside smoking. I can't pass you my hand or my face. And so if you want to add that extra layer of security, definitely having a mobile credential or having biometrics does provide that extra security, because at the end of the day, the individual becomes that perimeter, the individual becomes that credential, and that cannot be passed on. So definitely a layer of security that's available there.
Yeah, just for the reference, I don't smoke and I don't promote it.
Me neither. We'll go for coffee outside.
Yeah, coffee. So, interesting thing over the last year is also the test of access control limitation and connectivity limitation. So we're used, and many of my customers in banking and in retail are used to this locking down, mentality of locking down everything, so to meet governance and compliance for security measures, and lock down, keep it separate and safe. So Still, all of a sudden, we were forced into this remote working environment, and it's gonna stay like that. We kind of understand that there's no like coming back to work. It's just our normal reality, and this restricted system become very difficult to manage. So we start seeing these limitations on how we give access to the building, and more importantly, how we prevent access from those people who are not supposed to have this access anymore. No matter lockdown or not lockdown, we still need to give access to deliveries, maintenance, installation, whatnot, right? So it still all has to happen. So I see the clients coming to us and asking, how do we open this up? How do we give our staff the ability to manage access control remotely without compromising cybersecurity? So cloud comes into the picture, right?
Yeah, managing access rights with an access control system alone can be quite complicated, very manual process. So example would be, I want to come visit you in the office in Vienna. I don't have access to the Vienna office. I'd have to find out, number one, who do I need to ask? Who manages your office in Vienna so I could get rights to access it? That individual, the operator, then has to remember, okay, give Despina access. She's going to be here from June 4th to June 8th. He will then have to remember June 8th, remove access for Despina because she doesn't need there to be all the time. And oftentimes how they remember is through putting post-it notes on their screen or keeping an Excel file on hand to allow them to remember that. And obviously, you know, very manual process and can lead to security risks because human error is possible. They won't always remember to revoke access. So how we manage that is with what we call a physical identity and access management system, which is our ClearID solution that we introduced about almost 2 years ago now. ClearID uses a web-based portal that allows employees and contractors and visitors to ask temporary requests for a secured area. Once you know that request goes through and your time is up, the access rights are automatically revoked. As you could imagine, much more secure, much more simpler. It improves the flow of people within an organization, and it really relies on the company's security policies. Similarly for contractors, you mentioned deliveries and whatnot. A contractor can ask temporary access. The system will verify, are they certified? Have they done their drug and alcohol test? Do they have the right training? Based on all that and the organization's security policies, access rights will be given on a temporary basis. So much more secure and simple.
That's a great application, but this is an example of the cloud application. So how do you see the acceptance of the cloud solution in the market?
Again, like with anything, slow to uptake, although we have seen an increase. Unfortunately, with cloud, there has been a myth in the market that it's not as secure as an on-premise solution, which couldn't be further from the truth. If you really think about it, a cloud service, you know, instead of having the servers on the customer site, the servers are on the host site. And so all the cybersecurity measures when we implement into our access control system, be it on-premise or in the cloud, are exactly the same. And we do have secure ways to bring a customer to the cloud without ever piercing their firewall. And really, as mentioned, all cybersecurity aspects are being followed.
And quite recently, we had this panel with Christian Moran, so our listeners can just look up on the Genetec resources. And the interesting thing that, like, your isolated network, they're not more secure than the cloud infrastructure. It's not about where it's located. It's about how you manage the right. It's about the cybersecurity hygiene. And it's the risks are the same, if not worse, when you actually on isolated network, because it's very difficult to deliver patches. It's very difficult to have automated system to change the password because it's normally the cloud application. So it's all about the just overall cybersecurity hygiene. It's not about the infrastructure. Absolutely. So. Let's move forward beyond door question. What else can we do with our system in the post-COVID world and whatever it looks like? Yeah, and how do we drive more business insight from the system?
Yeah, so again, as I mentioned before, you know, oftentimes people, when they think about access control, oh, I could lock, unlock a door, a specific schedule for specific cardholders, we're good. But an access control system gathers so much information and so much data that customers can use that information to actually make better business decisions. One example is, you know, as you mentioned, many of us are probably never going to go back to the office full time. It's going to be on some part-time basis. Yet a lot of organizations are renting huge spaces that's costing them a lot of money. They can use their access control system to look at trends. How many people are coming in the office? What office, level of the building is being used the most? Which meeting rooms are being used? Based on that information that comes from their access control system, they can decide, hey, I don't need three floors of a building. I only need one for today's world. Similarly, again, occupancy rates, we could do that with an access control system. So there's a lot more a customer can do with their access control. And really, it's all about getting a return on their investment. Oftentimes, when thinking of switching access control, customers look at it as a capital expenditure. And yes, of course, there's going to be money to be spent. But really, there's a return on their investment because they could do so much more with their operations, with their intelligence, allowing their operators to react and do stuff much faster. So really, we have to think way outside the door when it comes to access control.
And actually, this kind of brings me to the question of optimization of operations, as you mentioned in the beginning of our conversation, the trend about frictionless frictionless readers. What are the options there?
Yeah, so there's quite a few options. One we saw a lot this year was facial reader, facial biometrics, waving of the hand, iris scanner. But then there's always a hesitancy, right? Customers are like, oh, but that, will that impede on my employees' privacy? We're taking a picture of their face to recognize who they are. But really, like with anything else, the privacy has to be protected. So it's something that we have to educate organizations about.
Yeah, and it's a very interesting when you're saying that this is a different reaction on the palm readers in comparison to the face recognition. As soon as it's biometrics, it's just you imprinted in the data. And it's all about how an organization manages the data, and it's not about the facial separately from a biometrics from your fingerprint or from the palm reader. And if it's GDPR compliant and if it's in an ethical way on opt-in manner, then I see it's only a great use of technology. So in banking, we see a usual use of a facial or the palm readers for the speed entering the gates in the corporate buildings. The same I see in retail, in the distribution centers. And recently I've had a conversation with one of the retailers who just implemented it, and it was only one employee out of thousands who didn't want to opt in the program, because it simply saves time and it saves this friction. So the last thing you want to do when you enter the distribution center for work, or you want to go home, to wait until everyone actually scans the card. So this speed regress is a great example of the ethical usage of the technology. Because I have these conversations with my customers when they potentially think of using facial recognition technology for the business inside. And even though you also can use it on opt-in manner, I think it's already on the borderline in invention privacy. So this is where you really need to consider, do you need it that much or not? So we really need to always have a balance between not inventing privacy to the customer, the end user customers for our customers, and actually the application.
Yeah, and you nailed it on the head when you said the ethical use of this technology. And I think it's very important that organizations do their homework when they're looking at biometrics. Who's the manufacturer? What's their rules against privacy? At Genetec, our motto is to really protect the everyday, protecting people, protecting their assets. But just as important is protecting people's privacy. In fact, the big motto of our CEO, Pierre Raz, is please remember to forget me. Because as much as it is important to protect people, the privacy is just as important.
Yeah, great. Well, that actually sums up our topic today. But before we go, we want to review a couple of questions. And one of the questions I see that what is the trends from your point of view and focus on the next years in the Benelux market? So I think I'll take this question simply. Yeah. Regional. So first of all, I think that the answer is all of the trends we discussed today. They're definitely the trends in the Benelux market. I think facial recognition is out of the conversation, especially in Belgium when it's banned. But the best way to go forward would be to consider the cloud options. And besides that, I think I will talk a little bit about unification. And as we know that access control and physical security solutions, they go in hand with the CCTV. And right now I see that there's more trends towards centralization and unification of the system. So the times of the DVRs are in the past, but now even though we go towards the cloud solutions, we also want to avoid using the cloud DVRs, how I call them. Don't use just the new just video subsystem. It will be underutilizing the technology. The future of with connectivity of different subsystems, connectivity of access control, intrusion panels, CCTV. This is where the return on investment, this is where the business case comes into the place. If you just use a video, it will be a deterrent function. It's very difficult to manage ROI. If you just use access control, it's just a function of giving access on letting this access away, taking the access away from the people. But when you connect, you actually start to generate business case, which either will allow you to save money or to generate money when we're talking about business inside, or like this Despina talk today is the beyond the door. We can understand how many office desks you need in your office. Are they being utilized? How often do you want to reduce the space and so on? So my answer will be, don't come from the on-prem to the cloud and without thinking, what can I do more? And utilize the technology of these days to the maximum. And I think it's, yes, of course, it's all over the place. The same answer would be, but in Benelux, the infrastructure is very established. So I think it's the readiness in that region is on the higher level. I hope that's answered your question. And I think we are approximately done with the talk for today. I hope you enjoyed it. And don't forget to subscribe to my offline channel, Coffee with Evgenia. It gives you some time during the day to have a coffee break. And we will wait for you for the next episodes, approximately in a month's time. And thank you, Despina, for joining me. Great talk. And I look forward to talking.
Thank you, Evgenia. Enjoy the coffee.
Thank you.